have microphones, but we're pretty sure the acoustics will work. If they don't, there are more seats up front. So my job is to keep things rolling along and to start things off in an interesting way. We actually had a phone call 2 days ago about what we might talk about. And then events yesterday made things all the more interesting. So I thought I'd start right off. I was going to ask about each of your view of the landscape for investment now in renewable energy. But why don't we start off saying, what should we take away from Solyndra? And how does that relate to the landscape of investment? Samir?
Well, first thing is thank God we didn't invest in it. But in all seriousness, you know, every firm is going to have, you know, failures, and unfortunately, some failures are just more visible than others. The thing to take away from it is that clean tech investing isn't bulletproof, right? You're going to have it was a bold bet. I thought it's a very interesting technology. Solar prices have gotten destroyed in the last couple of years. ASPs have gone down, and they just can't compete. It's very hard to compete with the Chinese in solar, where the Chinese government has basically given zero interest debt, and solar prices have gone down, and subsidies in Europe are going away. So I think, like in anything, you could say the same thing about, you know, one of the hottest areas of investing right now is social media, but you can look at Dig and MySpace and Friendster and companies like that have also failed. So every sector is going to have companies that fail.
And what is that? Does that tell us any more about other sectors in renewable area?
It just reminds you that in renewable energy, in energy investing, you're talking about commodity businesses. So you have to be cost competitive. And if you try to build a business that's going to be dependent on subsidies, you're going to fail.
Chris?
Oh, I agree entirely with that. You know, BP is the second biggest solar company, I think, and I'm told they've lost money consistently for 24 years, so.
Well, let me go back to that then. So, if you try to build a business that's dependent on subsidies, you're going to fail. How is anybody building any business in renewable energy right now?
Well, there are plenty of companies. When we invest, our thesis is pretty simple, is that if you have subsidies, we'll take it, but we don't invest in companies that we believe will be dependent on subsidies 5 to 7 years out. You're going to need it in the beginning, just like every other industry, steel industry, oil industry, all need a subsidy to get started. Why do you give subsidies? Because it's in our national interest to be more energy independent, period, full stop. You give subsidies to help kickstart the industry. At some point then the subsidies expire because companies have to be able to stand on their own. And our view is that we'll only invest in technologies that will be able to stand on their own when the subsidies expire. Doesn't mean that all of them, like a Solyndra, I'm sure the investors in Solyndra didn't expect the subsidies to stick around forever. The technology just wasn't able to get to the price point that they envisioned 5 years ago or 7 years ago. And no one could have envisioned the dramatic decrease in prices in the solar cells. We saw this in corn ethanol as well.
So I've been talking to the media the last couple days about this, and I keep getting asked, well, how much of this is the dramatic decrease in solar costs, and how much of it is the Chinese subsidies of solar? Do you have a take on that? And because if we're thinking about the future of these businesses, if China's going to continue to subsidize for a while, it could be bad news for a lot of businesses, couldn't it?
China, I think China's prices will eventually have asymptoted. You know, if you looked at, we passed on Solyndra, not because we didn't think it was a cool technology, but if you looked at the prices, their costs were very expensive. So I think China's prices will ultimately asymptote. And so there are a number of solar technologies out there that can compete for solar competing just fine, no matter what the Chinese are trying to do. Other companies won't. I think it's also healthy for the industry to have companies fail if they fail for the right reasons, which is that they're not able to compete. So.
Yeah, and I think, you know, if you look at what we're all trying to do, which is create an industry that's competing with a mature, entrenched industry with, you know, that's got 100 years of efficiency in it or plus, right? A $1 trillion plus industry. it's pretty ambitious to think that we're going to invent something new that can compete head on with it from the start, right? Everything we do, however, we also, you know, I should just fess up and say, you know, I'm mostly involved through my association with BP, and so even though I don't speak for BP, I have some insight into their business model. And you know, we believe that, for example, in biofuels, the only way it's ever going to work is if we can compete directly with petroleum on a price basis. And so that doesn't mean that for the moment, getting the first plants up and running, you know, we're very happy for the dollar a gallon subsidy. And in fact, we know that the first facilities we put up are not going to work perfectly. You know, it's impossible to go from pilot scale, where the whole industry is right now, to commercial scale without some mishaps. And so right now the subsidy is very helpful for sort of defraying part of the cost of the mishaps of getting up to full commercial scale. But when we're at commercial scale, if we can't do it in a direct competition with the price of petroleum, then we're not going to displace petroleum. So.
I also think that the media, as usual, does a terrific job of screwing these things up. We have to decide what do we want to do. So, you know, personally, I used to be, Chris, by the way, is one of my mentors. You know, he's very modest, but when I was younger, Chris really babysat me through genomics in the late 90s. So it's a real honor to be standing here getting to talk to him for an hour or so with you guys. But, you know, I left biotech investing to go into clean tech investing. Obviously, one point, I think it's a great way to make money. I think it's the biggest new industry, the biggest areas of innovation. And if I go to Berkeley, Stanford, Harvard, MIT, some of the brightest students want to work in this area. That's always a good bellwether for success and new innovation. Where are the smartest professors? Where are the smartest students? Where are the smartest PhD wanting to spend their time? Okay. We have to decide, and the second thing is that we send billions and trillions of dollars a year overseas on exporting. We wouldn't be in this federal deficit and the economy we're in if we didn't, if we were more energy independent. So if we want to be energy independent, let's just lay it out. We're going to have to help stimulate the industry. Not every company is going to fail. As a venture capitalist, 7 to 8 out of every 10 of our companies fail. That doesn't mean we don't get a Google or a Facebook or a Genentech or an Intel or a Cisco or an Oracle or an Apple. So all venture-backed companies. So we have to decide that we want an energy independence. So that's going to take some stimulus, some subsidies, and some patience. And you know, if we're all on that mission, so there's one company that failed. We've had 3 successful biofuel IPOs in the last 9 months. Let's talk about that. It's very easy to point at the little one-off mistake. And if we want to do that, then we should just kiss the idea of energy independence and stimulating the economy and creating jobs down the toilet. Because it's easy to find failures. Because you know what? 7 out of 10 of these are going to fail, I'll tell you right now.
So 2 years ago, would you have had the same presentation of this? You're focusing on energy independence and not mentioning climate change. And I'm trying to figure out why that is. Other than politically, certainly, the world has changed.
No, I think that the reason, we have a couple of companies that are building facilities in Mississippi. Haley Barbour is about as Republican a guy as you can comment. I'm shocked that I have a lot in common with him because I'm about a Democrat as they come. But you know, he looks at it really simple. He has to create jobs in Mississippi. He's got hundreds of paper mills that have shut down. He's got to repurpose people and he's got to find a way to create jobs. And he thinks this is a great way to do it. There's a lot of other benefits to renewable energy as well. But the one that I think is the most prominent is the biggest issue this country has is the economy right now. And just we have to do something that's American, do something to create jobs here. What do we do here anymore? I'll let Chris speak as well.
Well, I don't know what to say. I mean, Jim, you know, to follow up on what Samir was saying, you know, Jim Wolseley, the former CIA director, goes around giving a talk about, I guess, what does he call it, why we should stop sending $100 billion a year to our enemies. I guess that's his talk, right? And he says strategically, you know, we're basically funding both sides of many of the wars that we're involved in because the dollars we're shipping to buy oil elsewhere in the world actually funds a lot of the terrorism that comes back at us. And so he feels that strategically, it's much more important to get, you know, energy independence or energy security than it is. Well, I'm not sure it's more important, but I think he thinks it's more important than climate change.
I
think climate change is more important.
Chris, we're safe here.
Yeah. In fact, you know, it's funny you should say that. I was a professor at Stanford, and I was pretty reluctant to come to Berkeley because of its reputation. And in fact, one of the things that helped me make the transition to Berkeley was about the time I had to make the decision. There was a BERC meeting, and I came to the BERC meeting and realized, oh, it's actually safe for business and science here.
Another accomplishment of BERC. So, Samir, what do you see as the investment landscape right now? What's exciting, and what's the prospect for successes in the near-term future?
I still think renewable energy. We just raised another fund, and I think it's the most exciting area to invest. And we're and just like in anything else, there'll be cycles. So, you know, in 07 and 08, people thought biofuels were dead. It was just finished, and they painted that brush because of corn ethanol, which has a lot of negatives, a lot, and I'm not gonna sit here and support it, but that doesn't mean that biofuels have a lot of negatives. And like I said, we've had, in our portfolio itself, we've had three, and there's another one, Solazyme, down the street, four successful IPOs in biofuels in 2011. We never have thought that 3 years ago. It's all going cycles. So does that mean that solar will come back in a couple years? Probably. There will probably be new technologies that aren't the corn ethanol equivalent of solar that disrupt the market and come out and succeed. And so that's what we're looking for.
So what are the hot areas?
It's a pun, right? So some of the newer areas, I think there have been a lot of investments in biofuels and solar. So what are the new areas? So we're doing a lot in LEDs. We're doing a lot in energy efficiency. I was just in Michigan, so I was late. We have a company there that's trying to develop, the German professor that developed the Volkswagen TDI engine is working on a post-piston engine with us, and Bill Gates invested with us as well. Could be up to 50% more efficient. So what does that mean? That means you import half the oil that you would otherwise. That's massively disruptive. A lot of risk. Don't know if it'll work. But if that works, the beauty of clean tech investing, which you don't have in biotech or social media or anything else, we have no market risk. If I can make oil from renewable resources competitive at $80 a barrel, I can sell it all day. I have to focus on technology risk, and we know how to do that. But there's no market risk. I don't need to spend a bunch of money, then all of a sudden, like, how do I get customer acquisition, and how do I get retention, and all these things.
I think everybody here at Berkeley probably recognizes that the low-hanging fruit in terms of energy is energy efficiency, and yet it seems hard to get energy efficiency into the market other than, you know, LEDs are an example, I guess, but
and where LEDs else? 75% less electricity use, and they last longer. And so we're doing a couple of companies in LED, one with, you know, Shuji Nakamura out of UC Santa Barbara. He was the guy that invented the blue LED when he was at Nichia. We have this engine company in Michigan. We have a better fuel injector outside of northern LA. We've got battery plays. There's another pretty interesting company in Milpitas we have that does electrochromic glass. So I spent, it's interesting, it's so interesting to look at different perspectives. I spent Wednesday morning with the CEO of Alcoa. He just built a house. It was all glass. He said, "You Americans are crazy." And I said, "Well, please expand." You guys force us to put blinds inside, and that makes no sense, because I already have all the heat coming in. I don't want to just keep the house dark. I want to actually prevent the heat. Electrochromic glass. So there's a bunch of these kind of energy efficiency plays.
So it's glass that reflects.
You can change the transparency. So it can go dark to light, and then some intermediate stages.
So can you sell these in the market? So there's lots of energy efficiency out there that is on the McKinsey graph over on the left-hand side in the negative area that should be paying for itself.
We start talking about McKinsey graph.
No, let's not start talking about it.
Yeah, I'm
going
to go to that fraternity party.
Yeah, yeah. But that you would argue, and that most people would argue, this stuff pays for itself. And yet, it's not out there in the marketplace. And people, a lot lot of companies have gone broke trying to put it out there in the marketplace.
Again, remember, when I moved out here in 06, that we were one of the first firms to do renewable energy investing. It's 5 years. Yeah. Like Chris said, you're not going to disrupt industries in 5 years, and most likely the rate of failure is going to be exponentially higher in the beginning than it will in the end, just like it was in biofuels and it will be in solar and everything else as you learn. One of the bigger, a lot of the energy efficiency plays have been these kind of smart meters, smart thermostats sort of stuff. And that involves behavioral pattern change, like having people coming into your house and putting another little screen in your house. That's, we haven't invested in anything like that because, you know, I've got a thermostat, an alarm thing, I put another gizmo in the house, my wife will throw me out. So it's, you don't want to change consumer behavior.
So you think there is money to be made in actually changing the technologies?
Sure, absolutely. So you can, like our companies here, like if you're a real estate developer and you're building new houses or new construction buildings and you can install electric cover glass, right? What are the advantages? You're much smaller HVAC, right? You don't need to put in blinds. Then all the maintenance associated with HVAC and blinds go away. And if you're putting it into buildings, the price of it gets wrapped into the mortgage. So it becomes very, it doesn't become as offensive and upfront, hey, put this in, and you're not ripping out windows and reinstalling it. So I absolutely agree. And our engine company, Eco Motors, Navistar announced a big deal to put it in all of their trucks and buses. And the CEO of Navistar mentioned it in his earnings call.
I think he's touched on one of the problems with energy efficiency. You know, 40% of energy use is in buildings. But buildings have got a very long half-life, and people are, you know, reluctant to replace them just for energy efficiency. And so, but you know, I saw something interesting. Tom, have you seen Tom Siebel talk about C3 Systems?
Mm-hmm.
That's a really interesting company. So this is the guy that spun a company out of Oracle, and then, you know, eventually was bought back into Oracle, and now he's made a company that uses computational models of energy use for big companies. So, for example, a company like Dow spends $4 billion a year on energy. And he claims in his talks that they did a deal with Dow where they guarantee $1 billion a year in energy savings based on their computational models of Dow's energy use. And I guess he said they don't have any customers that spend less than $1 billion a year on energy, and they have 25 or 30 customers. I thought that was a very interesting business model.
Absolutely.
But selling energy efficiency historically has, firms have tried to do this, and the problems they've run into are verification and rebound within the customer. And does he have a way to overcome that? Is there a way to sell energy efficiency if customers aren't very cognizant of the real savings or don't trust them in many cases because they're hard to verify? And it's very hard for the seller to also really write a contract about
them. So the answer is, I think so. I think that if you're going to ask a customer to pay more monthly on the hopes of eventually saving money, I think that's a tough proposition. Okay, but you can go to the utilities. I think working directly with the utilities, there's a company called O-Power, which has done very well. And it's actually as much a behavioral psychology company as it is an energy efficiency company. They basically will send you an energy bill and show you how you're doing versus your neighbors. And they've had dramatic results. It was very, very impressive. There's another company that I saw recently, very cool, which looks at actually patterns of energy use and can tell you which one of your appliances is the most inefficient. So then you can start making changes. So people who have used it in beta thought, oh, it must be my AC that's really might drive my energy bill. Well, maybe it actually wasn't. It was their pump for their pool and these guys. So I think you have to enter these markets not charging people anything and letting them actually start to appreciate kind of where they can save money and demonstrate that for them before they actually even start writing checks. And I don't think the consumer's going to be the one that's going to write the checks. I think it'll have to come from the utilities.
So how do you sell LEDs?
Right. LEDs will be sold at Walmart, just like incandescent light bulbs and CFO.
People will pay extra for them?
Well, people will pay extra for LEDs up front if the overall lifetime of it is much longer. LEDs last years. Incandescent light bulbs last, you know, months at best. And they're probably going to be banned anyway, soon, anyways.
It'd be nice to ban these compact fluorescents. You know, I hate that mercury going in the environment.
Really?
Mercury is not a very good thing to be putting in the environment.
Although the argument I've heard made is that the mercury from the, at least in most parts of the country, from the coal-fired power plants is greater than the mercury in the
so, that's probably true. We're involved, we're interested in recycling, you know, municipal waste, and one of the problems with it is that there's a few things in that waste, like these bloody batteries with cadmium and mercury, and as well as the compact fluorescence that complicate what you can do with urban waste in terms of getting a nice clean stream.
And that's a good point. So one of the things that you learn as you do this, and again, where mistakes were made, hopefully won't be made for it, is you've got a lot of companies that are doing renewable materials, right? So, you know, when I was in college, I had the Nalgene in my backpack, and now you don't see those anymore because it's got BPA and it potentially causes cancer. My entire house is full now with seventh generation and Method cleaning materials. They don't really work that well, but if I brought in 409, I'd be thrown out. But it works much better. But anyway, we looked at a very cool company to replace terephthalic acid for plastic bottles. And the reason why I think the company will fail is that it's not a drop-in replacement. It's actually a replacement for terephthalic acid, so you can't recycle it. Because you have to actually extract it out, and the recycling cost is too offensive. So it's just, so you know, when you talk about what's the investment climate of these companies failing, it's just these things that you would never think of as you start to do new investing, that you have to kind of like, you just have to have a scarf on your back.
Nothing's environmentally benign.
Yeah.
So this is, everybody's getting along fine, so let's move to a subject that I know you disagree on. That is the role of big companies in innovation. Samir, why don't you lay out your views of where innovations come from and how?
I'm pretty strong on. I don't think big companies can innovate at the same rate as startups. I think I can't think of the last time a big company had a massive innovation. Now, that doesn't mean a startup can bring things to scale and market as well. What the big companies are great at is they have big balance sheets, they have scale, they've got the supply chains in place, they've got the channel to market, they've got the brand. Small companies, very hard to compete with that, especially initially. But in terms of innovation and working, you know, being nimble and agile, I think that I would take the R&D departments of my startups over the R&D departments of big companies any day.
And why is that? So you're a big company and you'd like to be in on these things. Why can't you set up the incentive system?
Just think of it as a startup. When Chris and I did LS9 and we had 12 people in the company, you never saw the parking lot empty before 8 or 9 at night. People just worked. Okay? It gets to 50, half the parking lot. Gets to 100 or so, all of a sudden, you know, you just can't, it's just very hard to maintain that kind of culture of, and look, and the kind of people that want to join. You think the top computer science engineer from Berkeley or Stanford, forget IBM or HP, wants to even go work at Google now? Probably not.
So he wants to be part of something that's small and that
have impact, there's massive wealth creation opportunity. I don't know, Chris, what you think.
So maybe you do.
I entirely agree with that. But what I have a kind of a different perspective, and that is, can we really change the energy sector with little companies? No matter how innovative, you know, I think the little companies by themselves can't do it. The scale of the problem is, you know, is so big that there's just not enough depth of capital in small companies. So I think ultimately these small companies end up being providers of technology to large companies. So we've got to have a synergy between the large and small companies.
I fully agree. There's no way, how can we compete with Exxon at $100 billion a year?
Exactly.
But there's no way that Exxon can innovate as fast as my companies. And you know, where big companies have made it, the smart big companies, so You know, in the fuels area, you know, there was a large oil company from the Netherlands that basically would come into startups and offer pretty attractive financials, but really lock them up, basically affect them, make them their R&D arm. And none of our companies took that deal because you capture upside, and that doesn't make any sense. And so the large company did a bunch of deals, and they've all pretty much fallen by the wayside because it was negative selection. The good companies would never cap their upside. So the companies, the large energy companies, and if you go back, you know, Vinod, my boss, partner, always tells me this thing, you know, when he started Sun in 82, you had digital equipment and Apollo and Data General and all these massive companies, right? And they're all gone now. And you would never have imagined that back then. You know, the McKinsey study, give me a break, right? And McKinsey in 1990 said there'd be like 1 million subscribers, cell phone subscribers by 2010. So, right, so I mean, you know, so it's just a, you know, you can't extrapolate the future by
just getting back. Of course, Bill Gates also said that there would only be 1 million personal computers.
He made 40 billion right answers, though.
Yeah.
And afforded him some mistakes. But I truly believe that if we continue to innovate as well as we're doing at startups in clean energy, the oil and gas companies that remain on the sidelines and don't find a way to kind of incorporate in the right way could fall mercy, just like we've seen in the computer industry, or even like the AT&T's. You know, AT&T was bought for a brand.
But then let's think it through. So if a startup company can't become a true, you know, huge fuel company, it has to, because one of the problems in the field, let's say in fuels, ignoring electricity or other forms of energy, I think Exxon and Shell both have less than 3% of the world market. Right? So you know, unlike the biomedical market, where if you've got a new drug lead, Pfizer, someone will come and pay you for exclusive access to that and give you a big premium for that exclusive access, right? But in the energy field, these companies that only have 3% of the market aren't going to come and pay you for exclusive access.
I left biomedical investing because I think it's the worst way to make money in venture capital. Exactly for that. You're a startup, you spend $100 million, you have one molecule, okay? And then you have to license it to Pfizer or Merck, and that's it. So I used to argue my old partnership, when as soon as we got that deal done, shut the company down, give out all the cash, and just sit there with one accountant, waiting to see if you get a royalty off of the thing. Why continue to innovate? Because it's like playing blackjack. You won, get off the table. The odds of you getting another drug to phase three is so low, zero. You got one, go home.
Interesting business advice.
So, but I'm serious. If you think about it, if you go and look at the companies that continue to try to get other drugs to phase three, most of them have failed. And they would have been better off following my advice.
So let's come back to
energy. So energy. So on energy, it's very different. You don't have to give exclusivity.
Right.
You don't want to pay for it, and I don't want to give it to you. Well, you know what I want? I want you to put up the capital to build the first few plants. Because then I can go to Wall Street and get the rest of mine to scale. I'm not really competing with you because the market's so big. It's perfect.
Exactly.
This is why I'm a clean tech investor, because there is a way to make this work. Because you could never pay me enough to give you worldwide exclusive. You couldn't make it work in your own books. Because I would do the analysis based on the overall size of the market. You only have 3% of it. The numbers don't work.
Right.
But you'd love to build 5 or 10 plants, or build as many as you want. But I won't give you exclusive.
But then you're a royalty business. Is that what you are?
No, absolutely not. Just for a limited amount, right? Because how many are you going to build? You're not going to take over the whole oil market. I'll give you 10 plants, right? The minute you build the first one and show that it works, I'll go get funding from anyone else, if it's economic, to continue to build my business. And you're not going to compete with me. The market's too big.
Right.
So I've been listening to this and trying to figure out what's different here. And it sounds like basically you're betting on the technology just not expanding fast enough to set the world price, that you're still going to be competing with the incumbent technologies. And so you can let this guy build 10 plants, and you're not worried that it's going to start actually
driving a car fast enough, and you can make a lot of money in the meantime.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be my technology, it's commercializing, and all he's doing is increasing the value of my technology by showing that it scales. Because the odds of BP scaling my technology better than me are much, much higher, because they know what they're doing.
So, what, when you talked about energy independence and we have to get serious about this, we're pretty clear now we're not going to have a price on carbon in the United States anytime soon. What regulation are you betting on in the short run? It's not going to be a carbon price. And you do have to make money in the short run, even if it is 5 to 7 years. What do you think is coming and what are you sort of counting on?
Well, I'm counting on nothing from the federal government. That'd be foolish at this point. You know, I think there's a lot of policies in place already, you know, whether it's tax rebates or renewable fuel standards or the CAFE standards for automobiles, which are just fine. I think you don't want to take those away. That would be a problem. But I don't bet on a car price. In 07 or 08, I would have thought there would have been a price of carbon. I didn't make investments based on a price of carbon, but I would have said there's a pretty high likelihood there will be a price of carbon. I don't think there's a price of carbon for 5 years at this point. So I'm not waiting for any legislation.
So you don't see any new regulations coming down that will really drive investment at this point?
You know, one thing they're doing is Feinstein voted, I think, correctly to remove the VTEC, which is the ethanol blender's credit, which is something like 51 cents, and to reduce the budget. And that, if you aggregated that out, that was about a $2.5 billion pool. And so instead of just eliminating that, which I think what the bill that she and Coburn put together makes a lot of sense, is say, look, let's take 10% of that and distribute that for cellulose. And I think that makes sense, because you're getting a 90% back into the kitty, but you're still allocating. But I don't know, Chris will know probably policy better than me, but I don't see a whole lot coming down the pipe right now.
Well, actually, maybe Severin knows better. I mean, what about AB32? Is AB32 not going to bite someday in terms of carbon?
AB32 is the California greenhouse gas standard. The market's probably going to start, and when it does, there will be a price for carbon. I think there's a real issue of whether that price for carbon will actually change the national carbon mix, or will simply reallocate low carbon fuels to California. The California also has a low carbon fuel standard, and I think there are real questions about how much that's actually going to do as well. That actually is going to put a premium on ethanol because it's getting credit, probably more credit than it should, on corn-based ethanol. But the U.S. is already doing that, and that's one of the existing regulations.
And don't 20 states follow California in terms of these things, or is that?
Fewer and fewer. So we started out with a large coalition, and as California has gotten closer to it, it's gotten smaller and smaller. So California is still talking to a few other states and Canadian provinces, which actually are more serious about it. British Columbia will have a $30 carbon tax by, I think, next year or the year after.
Which is interesting. Maybe you can explain how that works, because I think they're returning the tax to the people rather than keeping it as a government.
Yeah, it looks a lot like the Alaska Oil Fund.
So if I understand it, the government is charging big energy producers a carbon tax, and then they're rebating it to the public. Is that not how it's
I
going?
I think that's right.
I was at a meeting with George Shultz, you know, the former, Treasury Secretary and many
Treasury
other things,
Secretary,
right?
Defense.
But most importantly, a Republican. And he was citing this British Columbia law as the path forward for the United States, and it started a movement here, actually, a political movement, to try and implement that strategy, which I thought was very fascinating, because Columbia is fundamentally, pretty on the left, I would say.
George Shultz is a circa 1995 Republican. He is not a circa 2011.
Clearly.
It's a good thing. I mean, like I said, we've had a phenomenal relationship with Haley Barbour of Mississippi. It's not quite so hot on policy party lines. And yet, George Shultz has been a terrific supporter of the Hoover Institute.
Yeah.
We had Condi Rice joining one of our renewable fuel boards.
You know, I was involved in, so a couple of years ago, the governor's office here asked a group of people, scientists, to tell us how the state of California could implement AB 32. So we went through a two-year process trying to, you know, and AB 32 requires a fundamentally a 90% reduction over current greenhouse gas emission levels, which is, it was very amazing. And so we had about 40 scientists, including a couple of Nobel Prize winners in the room, saying, okay, and everybody came in with their piece of technology. You know, the solar guys thought it's going to be solar, the biofuel people, and we have nuclear in the room as well. And by the end of the two-year process, actually, we realized several things. That if, the most important was if we put everything on the table, including 40 gigawatts of nuclear, we couldn't get it down to 90%. Because just the load following for the renewable electricity broke the bank on carbon. That is, you know, load following is if you're using wind and photovoltaic for a substantial amount of your energy, you have to have parallel natural gas generator for when the wind is not blowing or the sun's not shining. And just those emissions were by themselves more than the 90% reduction would allow.
You didn't have demand response people in the room.
Well, the one thing we didn't put on the table was behavior modification. And so that's clearly what's required, I think, to meet it, yeah.
Or energy storage.
Yeah, good transition.
Energy storage.
Let's talk about energy storage.
No one could envision any energy storage that was on the scale that we needed, yeah.
There's no solution out there yet. I mean, we have a bunch of, kind of, I didn't think about that when you asked what the new, we have a compressed air storage company. We have...
So what does it do? Why don't you say what it does? What's the idea?
Well, the idea is basically you're capturing your
ground.
Well, you can do it in caverns. This is actually in an engine. You're using an engine, doing isothermal expansions and compression. So you're bringing it in, compressing it, and then when you want electricity, you're pushing it out. And the question will be, what's the round trip efficiency of the energy you're bringing in and versus out? And that has to be pretty high for it to be economical, because these are pretty big engines. We've looked at a lot of flow cell batteries. Some of our own battery companies could also be involved in energy storage. We looked at flywheels. So we've got some kind of projects in that space. We haven't found anything yet that, there's nothing ready, at least that we see in our portfolio for prime time. But it's clearly an area that everyone's looking at. It makes a dramatic difference.
So I started studying energy in the mid-70s, right after the energy crisis. And storage was right around the corner, just as fusion was at the time. Fusion is still ways off. Is storage still ways off?
You know, I can't credibly say that I see a solution where they don't still have dramatic risk before they would have an answer. So,
It's far off, right? The present cost per kilowatt hour.
Yeah, so I'd say it's not around the corner. If around the corner means the next couple of years, I don't see it.
Has science actually discovered new barriers more than new breakthroughs? Or is it just that?
You know, let me give you a number that I've been told. I haven't done the calculation myself, but I'm told that when we gas up our car, when you put the thing in the tank, that's 16 megawatts going in. That's the energy density of the gasoline you're putting in, 16 million watts. That's going to be very, very hard to replace with storage. You know, it turns out, you know, gasoline is a great storage form. It's a very, very high energy density. And you know, the current generation of batteries are also operating at about 50% of theoretical energy density already. So we're certainly, for the fleet at least, we're not going to see a big breakthrough.
It'll be more, I think, on the generation side, so for solar and wind. Because wind is really cheap,
yeah,
if it's there when you want it. And there's enough headroom that you can layer on, you can probably double or triple the cost of wind by adding storage and still make it economical.
Yeah.
Especially if you deploy it at peak.
But what form? Certainly not battery, not conventional batteries.
So. No, it would have to be like compressed air or...
Like a flywheel.
So we've been hearing about flywheels for 40 years now,
yeah,
and they're still not there. So I'm trying to figure out what's likely to be.
My bet is, just like in anything, there's not going to be one answer, so there'll be multiple. I think ultimately there'll be a flow cell battery type thing that works. There'll be compressed air that works. I just don't. And even though we have our own efforts in our portfolio, there's nothing I see that's ready in the next couple of years.
Should we move to Q&A?
Yeah.
I have more questions, but I figured I'd let other people in. Sir, why don't you stand up when you ask questions? People will hear you better.
So for your investment strategy, you talk about energy independence. Just wondering, like, do you not look foreign investment at all? Like the big Chinese solar companies are the leaders. You know, Denmark's the leader in wind and those sorts of things. Europe's with the energy subsidies. Are you not looking foreign for investments?
No, of course. We're sure we're
not.
No, sure we are. So we've invested. One of our solar companies came out of Australia. We have a biofuel company that came out of the Netherlands. We have another biofuel company that came out of New Zealand. So we'll look everywhere. I think the challenge is, it's just a practical challenge. You know, the closer the company is to us, the easier it is for us to manage the investment and help the company. And I think while there's talent all over the world, I think the entrepreneurial culture is stronger still in the United States. So.
Really?
Absolutely.
So when you talk about energy independence, and what do you mean?
What I mean by energy independence is that we need to be, for a number of reasons, we need to have more energy produced here in the United States than by being dependent on foreign sources of energy.
So if that's really the motivation, though, why aren't, and if we're really...
My motivation?
No, if you think that's the, should be the driving motivation, why aren't we just building a lot of coal-fired power plants?
Well, I think we talked about this on our call, so I should have been better prepared. The coal-fired plants, first of all, just deal with electric generation, so they don't deal with transportation fuels. So that's one massive side of the equation.
But coal to liquids is a technology that exists.
Very uneconomical. It is yet to be a massive scale to make it. The only time coal to liquid has really worked well is when there's been no other choice. So South Africa did it, and Germans did it because they were basically embargoed from the rest of the world. They had no other choice, at which point there is no cost you have to match. So that's not a good example. Most of our foreign imports are really deal around transportation fuel. It's oil. And so I think that, to me, is the biggest thing that we need to solve. On the coal side, though, if you wanted to go deeper into that, the question is, what are the health risks and other costs, indirect costs associated with lining up coal plants? Their estimates, and I can't speak that I've done the math on it, but their estimates that with all the coal plants that are being built in China, you know, almost one a week, that soon the health benefit, health deterioration, could override the economic growth that's caused by this. So, you know, that's how it...
What about natural gas vehicles?
Again, changing infrastructure. I think natural gas for car makes a lot of sense. The same reason why ethanol struggled and continues to struggle is that, okay, you have E85 cars, that's one thing, where are you gonna go fill it up? You gotta create new pumps, and people aren't gonna put the money to do that. With natural gas, same thing. You have to put in some gizmo at your house or have standard infrastructure. If you're going to make a bet on changing infrastructure, I think you'll fail.
Well, I think we are going to see some natural gas and fleets in particular, right? Because those are
concentrated, right? So you can do FedEx buses. India did that. If you go to Delhi versus Bombay, it's a marked difference. As a kid, you get sick because the pollution was so bad. In Delhi now, all of the public transportation is compressed natural gas. It's fantastic. It's so much cleaner. You go to Bombay, it's not. It's a huge difference.
But really, the air quality is still awful in Delhi. Just
I think that we will see a lot of that, and there's a good opportunity for innovation there as well. The problem with natural gas, we have a lot of stranded natural gas. It's not close enough to a pipeline. And if there was good technology for converting it to methanol, for example, you know, that would be valuable technology.
That'd be great. Now we actually have it. So we have a company in Denver, which is you have in coal beds, you have in situ bugs that basically naturally convert the coal into natural gas. And there are ways you could accelerate that process. And so we've made one investment in that kind of company in Denver. Still early. Don't know how well it'll work. But I read something recently, Chris, that estimates of how much natural gas we actually have are overshot.
Yeah, it's
New York Times had a big article on that. It's unclear whether a lot of people disagree with that.
Well, it's hard to tell also, just even in the coal beds, how thick the coal beds really are.
But you know, there's something called the mobile process. It's a catalytic process for making gasoline directly from natural gas. And they ran it in New Zealand for 10 years commercially. And that will come back, I think.
This is the methanol to gasoline.
Methane to gasoline. It's like a Fisher trope, so it had a big capital cost. They had to have to build it big, but now there's
a company called Methanex. Yeah, New Zealand really doing that.
Right.
Just the scale.
Right.
So, yeah.
It doesn't lend itself to startups anyway. Let's put it that way. It's something that the petroleum industry already knows how to do, and I just project that we're going to see it coming back because there is a lot of natural gas now all of a sudden.
They are building refineries again in the United States, so there's a new one opening up in Louisiana, in fact.
Yeah, well, that's interesting because, you know, the community I live in, our goal is to get 30% transportation fuel from biomass in the next 30 years, and if that's actually true, we're going to start retiring. Our goal is to start retiring refineries.
Well, you could use the capacity for something else. So,
you know, they're pretty specialized.
No, but you could use hydrotreaters to treat bio-crude.
That's true.
As opposed to just using it for...
That's true. For companies like Kior, for example.
We're working with Hunt and Chevron to find the gas.
Let's take another question. Yes, sir.
So my name is Praveen. I'm an MBA exchange student here. So my question is, when you compare fuel tech investment vis-a-vis the clean tech investment, essentially there are a lot of dependent factors that is in terms of regulation, in terms of acceptance, technology risk, and so on and so forth. Essentially, the clean tech investors are taking much more risk than a pure tech player. And so what is that? You go to the investors, and one thing that convinces the investors that you're going to essentially have much more returns investing in clean tech sector than a pure tech sector. And why does
pure
it make
tech?
Business?
Are you mean the
traditional IT and infrastructure and so on? So what is that still convinces the investors, meaning the limited partners, for example, that you're going to return or bring much more returns than a pure tech investor?
Well, so our fund is half and half. So our fund is both clean tech and IT. And I think that's always wise to be diversified because there are going to be times in which one is hotter than others. I think the way we look at clean tech is that we truly believe it's the biggest new opportunity in this country to innovate, and we're seeing a lot of great innovative ideas. The markets are unended. You know, in tech, it's hard to know how big the markets really are, how big are they, and the customer acquisition and competition is ferocious. Also, there's a lot of competition in tech. Just look at the valuations of a lot of the tech companies nowadays, because you've got so many people who can invest and our competition. You know, we've got a pretty solid brand in clean tech. And you know, in venture, what I've learned is having proprietary deal flow is probably the most valuable asset you can have. And I think in clean tech, we've established that brand. In IT, it's harder for any one venture company to say that they've got proprietary deal flow.
Despite the lack of track record in clean tech investing, you're still investors at
companies? I've personally had three IPOs in the last 9 months. If you want to go on Google and find an IT investor that's had three IPOs in 9 months, I'd be happy to chat with you again.
Thank you.
Question right behind you.
Hello. I'm worried. I'm not in business. I'm in semiconductor science. But I'm interested in your opinions of hydrogen or some of these synthesized fuel sources based on there's a lot of research that's being done at catalytic activities. Normally when you talk about fuels, somebody mentions hydrogen, so I'm going to be that person. Can you comment?
So again, it's another one of the things where infrastructure, you have to change the fleet, you have to figure out, if you get the technology, there's a lot of cool technology. There's a professor at Harvard that's done some very cool work on basically splitting water and storing hydrogen. Again, it just becomes an infrastructure thing. You're changing the infrastructure, you're changing behavior. And I just think that's a very difficult thing. Even if it mathematically or scientifically makes sense, the harsh reality is that you're going to have to create hydrogen cars, hydrogen storage stations, and people are going to have to invest lots of capital to do that. And I think that's a difficult thing to pull off.
Well, I want to revise that and say that that's all true. Lind and BMW in Germany are actually starting to build a hydrogen network, but there's other things you can do with hydrogen. If you can make green hydrogen, there, you can use it other than just as a, in a fuel cell. So we, for example, can see many ways to reform biomass into better, much higher value fuels if we had a green
sure.
source of hydrogen. So anybody that can make hydrogen, come see me. So we can definitely find a path to market for it.
You can also use it for electrolysis and things like electrochemistry and things to make
yeah,
PVC.
But the really big value actually is that you can almost double the fuel value of biomass if you've got a source of hydrogen, because we know how to reduce the biomass to gasoline and diesel directly if we could have green hydrogen.
And are we going to have?
Yes, we are. And actually, here at Berkeley, there's a huge and very leading activity in water splitting based on new catalysis. So I think we will see, if you ask me, where is a technical innovation coming that's game-changing? Water splitting, not electrolysis per se, photolysis of water is one of the opportunities making hydrogen from sunlight. The white paint will do it at a low efficiency already, so it's not a miracle. Yeah,
I'm just curious to return a little bit to the role of the big companies in the innovation process, especially in the energy space where, as you mentioned, it's really a commoditized business. You know, even the big tech companies, if you asked them, companies like Microsoft and IBM, what will you be selling in 15 years? I think probably the one truism is that they wouldn't really know what they were going to be selling, and they would admit that. How does a big company like ExxonMobil or BP or Shell or whatever that will still tell you they're going to be selling oil and gas in 15 years, it participate in an innovation cycle?
It's the same molecule, just the source is different.
But if it's not a drop-in fuel, if we're talking about
a drop-in fuel, and which can be derived, it can be derived from biomass as opposed to just digging in the oil. It's the same molecule.
Because of my affiliation with BP, I have to say BP has a huge renewable energy activity. So as I said, they're the second biggest, second biggest still photovoltaic company. They're one of the biggest wind companies. They've invested $500 million here at Berkeley in biofuels and now have 2,500 employees. They've made $5 billion of investment in biofuels in the last 5 years. So they are building a renewable portfolio. But that's entirely due to the fact that there was a visionary guy at the helm there a few years ago, and none of the other big companies, well, Shell to a little bit.
Shell did it wrong. BP's had the best drive we've got far.
BP seems to be the only one. But our belief is that BP is now building, for example, its first generation commercial cellulosic facilities, and we think that when they have the money to do it, and certainly the chemical engineering capability. When they're up and running, we think that will actually trigger a lot of others to do it. But there's a lot of close followers that are happy to do it once somebody else does it.
So I'm realizing that there are two different questions going on here that I hadn't really clued in on. What you're talking about, the sort of investment scale, not the world changing, because you can make money, and your point is you're going to make money for a long time while the oil is still setting the price. But at some point, if you're going to really change the world, which I guess in terms of climate change, we're going to need to, you're going to start setting the price, and particularly you're going to tank the price of oil. That's got to happen.
It's got to happen. The question is, how long does it take, and what volume of the overall market do you have to take? And it's hard to imagine that a company like Exxon only has 3% of the market. It's tough as a smaller company to imagine that you'd have 10x that kind of impact.
But okay, so switching back to your other point though, so Delhi is now running most of its public, it's all of the auto rickshaws are natural.
As far as I
see,
my
understanding too. Why isn't that a model for transition to natural gas, to CNG vehicles?
Oh, I think I agree with Chris. I think fleet vehicles it should be.
And you don't think that could then spill over to start making it more attractive for people to?
It's a start. It'll be the on the pathway to it. If you try to go right to the consumer, I think it'll be a mistake.
You can buy natural gas.
Sure, Honda Civic will have it. A friend of mine have it. Put a little thing in your house, and
it might come.
It it's all about scale. It's like, what's the scale? You know, the gentleman here asked me a question. Has to be drop-in, absolutely. If you bring the same molecule into the pipelines, the oil companies will love you because they don't have to then go to Chavez and some of these guys and do that.
You know, I think that there's a kind of a when you want to change a trillion-dollar industry, you should expect it to be generational change, right? But there's an expectation. Something I find very frustrating is that, you know, we're making real progress in substantially changing the fuel sector, but the popular press at the current moment thinks it's a failure, that it's all failed because it didn't happen yesterday. And you know, when you want to make change on the scale that we're talking about, it just takes some time to build a single biorefinery. Really, it's like $500 million capital investment, and it takes about 4 or 5 years to get it permitted and designed and brought online. And so, you know, that's just like outside the lifetime of the average journalist.
And no one knew what clean tech was in 2006.
Yeah, exactly.
It's actually annoying.
Yeah, exactly.
And our moderator, you know, it's annoying too. Start with a cylinder, then you have poke you. Come on.
Yeah, I'm just thinking, in terms of biofuels, you know, this year.
Could you imagine if you were interviewing, like, Jim Harbaugh, and the first thing, what about that game you lost, right? he'd probably get away with punching the moderator a bunch.
Wow.
I hit a sore spot. Chris,
well, I just wanted to point out in terms of, you know, this year in biofuels, you know, we're making enough biofuel to provide all the transportation fuel of the fourth largest economy in the world. That whole German economy could run all the transportation could run biofuels. So it's not some sort of nascent thing that might take off. And that's all in like 6 years.
Look at Brazil did.
Yeah,
it
Brazil.
It didn't take 40%. 50 years to change to. In 10 years, they went from 5% to 95% of their cars being flex fuel. And you go to Brazil, and every gas station gives you two choices, 25% alcohol or 100% alcohol. And look, is it coincidence that Brazil has emerged from kind of a run-of-the-mill country to one of the most powerful countries at the same time period?
So actually, 40% of their transportation is now from bio, and 15% of their electricity is from bio now.
So could that happen in the U.S.?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Definitely going to make it happen here.
And did Brazil do it with policy or did they do it with business?
Yeah, they had a military government that was very helpful.
We don't foresee that in the United States, right?
We don't foresee that, yeah. So
we can't
have a tougher job.
Yeah, we just can't make it. But you know, think about it, though, is that Brazil, the same thing with China, they decide to do something, there isn't this good one. It's just a... Sometimes you have to be a little more aggressive on policy to just get things done.
Do you foresee that happening?
No, it's not going to be. Unless the Tea Party takes over.
But that's the closest thing to a military guy.
Actually, this guy. Yeah, go
ahead. This question is for Samir. Imagine for a minute that you're graduating at the end of the year. So what company would you, within your portfolio or outside of it, would you want to work for?
So I'd say the coolest company I'm working on right now has something to do with energy, but is more environmentally focused. So in Berkeley, I could talk about this. So one of the biggest issues one of the things that I hate are slaughterhouses. It's just a pretty, you know, gross and inhumane thing. And so we've got a company that's making non-dairy meat and cheeses. And it's not like the Boca burger that tastes like cardboard and costs $10 at Whole Foods. It's actually I can't keep going. We're not thinking about the health benefit, we're thinking of the source of the food. And by definition, it'll be healthier. So I think we're actually gonna be serving our cheeses at big events in New York this fall. I tried it yesterday. Where you couldn't tell it's a nut-based versus a dairy-based cheese. And the meat product is a little bit further away, but you know, it's such an inefficient process. You feed cows corn, and then you get beef on the back end. It's like 10% of the protein ends up in the human. It's such a horrible, and then you take the way that they treat animals and slaughterhouses, the environmental, it's a mess. So I think that's pretty cool.